This is the Bartholow Coal Company from Fine Scale Miniatures. This is Jewel Series number 9. It was released in 2006. It's one of 800 that was made. The original retail price was $285, and you can still get this on eBay as I'm making the video right now. I see it pop up every once in a while for various different prices. If you're willing to wait around long enough, you can usually get it for less than what the original retail price is. Fine Scale Miniatures was founded by George Selios, and he also created the Franklin and South Manchester Railroad. And the Franklin South Manchester Railroad has the same initials as Fine Scale Miniatures by intent. He created the railroad after the company. I decided to get this kit because it was such a funky looking building. This kit includes one main building and three smaller buildings. One of the smaller buildings is the wooden laser cut clapboard, and the other two you build out of cardboard and they have sort of batten supports. So let's see what's in the box. Fine Scale Miniatures usually includes a poster with color pictures of George Selios' build, and that's usually really helpful. The instructions are kind of poster sized. And I'll be honest, on this build, I really didn't read the instructions at all. I really just built everything off of the cards. This kit includes metal strips for the corrugated roofing. I didn't use those. I used some that I already had painted up from previous builds. Some were metal, some were paper. And this kit included a roll of paper shingles, and I didn't use those either. In one of my previous builds, I had used the paper shingles from a roll and I really hated them, so I replaced those with another brand. You'll see that later. This is my third Fine Scale Miniatures build, and I'm going to keep it pretty simple. I'm not going to do anything really new that hasn't been shown in some of the other videos. So if you like watching build videos, then just follow along. So here's cardboard sheets that you use to cut out the roofs and the walls for some of the smaller batten style buildings. I'm not including the cardboard buildings in this video because, frankly, I haven't quite figured out how to build them to look good enough. So this video is just the main building and the wooden clapboard office. These Jewel Series kits include really nice metal castings. Generally, you don't need to file them at all. But it seems to be pretty much the same set of castings for each of the kits that I've built. Same doors, same windows, same accessories, drums, barrels, whatever. And you can still get the castings online just as a separate thing. So if you're looking for some details for model railroading, I think you can just get a set of castings. Construction for the kits generally starts out the same. Add trim to the walls and supports, bracing for the walls. Here we get to the supports for the main building, and this is where the cards come in with the full-size templates. I like to use blue tack and 1-2-3 blocks to hold pieces to the card as I line them up, and then I glue them in with a very small amount of glue. So sometimes the glue will glue the pieces to the card, but it just comes off with a razor blade, so it hasn't been too much of a problem. So I have to make 4 of these supports. This part of the build starts to get a little bit tedious. I have to build 8 of the walls for the chutes of the building, and these are all basically scratch built from wood provided with the kit. So I glue the main frame to the card with blue tack and then start attaching the individual boards. once all the boards are on, then I just trim off the excess with a razor blade. After all of the trim and bracing has been applied, I sprayed all the walls with a gray primer from a spray can. It's just an enamel primer. That helps to seal the wood from water so the acrylic paint does not damage the wood. And so now I'm starting with the base coat. I'm using basically the same paint technique I used on my Hayes & Boyd kit because I really liked the way that looked with kind of the gray and red. So the base coat is Barn Wood from Folk Art. So Folk Art is a pretty cheap paint and it goes on pretty sloppy, a lot of brush strokes, but that's okay because everything is going to get covered up later. The next step is a wash of Vallejo Dark Gray Wash. As you can see, it's practically black and it goes on very intense. Now, it's a really nice wash because as it goes on, you see a lot of brush strokes, but that all evens out as it dries. So it looks really good once it's dry. Now, I've tried doing this with just a wash of like cheap black paint and it doesn't have the same effect. So I think it's important at this step to use the Vallejo wash. I used an airbrush to paint the supports because it's such an awkward shape, but I have to use a brush to put the wash on. So same technique. The next step is a fairly heavy dry brush of Vallejo Silver Gray. This is a little heavier than what your normal dry brushing would be because you still want to have some streaks. And if you get any blotches of color in there, that's okay, they can get covered up later. I really developed this technique looking at a bunch of old barns, and the color of the wood really is not brown, it's really a black and gray color. So that's what I'm simulating here. Now we get to what would be the actual paint color of the building. In this case, I'm using Folk Art Rookwood Red. And I'm applying it with a sponge. And this is just a natural sponge. You get this at the art section of the art supply store, like Hobby Lobby. And what I'm trying to do here is to concentrate the paint in certain areas of the wall rather than evenly across the wall. That seems to be what I see in old barns and things that I look at. You also have to apply this paint technique to strips of wood because they're going to come in handy later. You're going to need them for trim and for the rafters. And on multiple occasions, I had to go back and paint strips of wood. So it was kind of nice to have a paint technique that was pretty easily reproducible. This is the building that they refer to as the office building. And I'm going to use basically the same paint technique, but I'm going to use a two-tone. So I've masked off one section of the walls and I'm applying the accent color, which in this case is a blue color. I also masked off so I could paint the trim. Had I thought about it ahead of time, I would have painted the trim separately and glued it on. That's what I've done in the past. But actually, this was kind of easy, and I might think about doing this more in the future. So with the trim color applied, I then mask off the trim areas and I'm applying the white, which would be the main wall color. One of the interesting aspects of the main building is it has the studs exposed on the exterior of the two walls. And so here I've attached the wall to the card. And I'm putting in the studs, trying to line them up with the drawing. The studs I also had to paint with the same paint technique so that they match the walls. And in this case, I think it was pretty important to paint the walls without the studs first, because if you put the studs on and then try to apply the paint with the sponge, it would just not go on anywhere near evenly. So it's important to paint the wall first and then apply the studs. At this point, it's time to apply the sign. So I just put some white glue on the back of the sign and glue it onto the wall, and I burnish it in using a wood toothpick. That seems to work the best and it doesn't tear the sign. I think it's pretty difficult to try and get these paper signs to look good on these clapboard buildings, so I only went with one sign in this particular case, even though they gave you many more. With the sign glued in, I masked around it, and now I'm going to apply the gray paint over the sign to give the sign a worn appearance. And in addition to the gray paint, then I'm going to apply the red paint to help with the faded appearance of the sign. So it's time to install the windows. The windows in this kit are plastic. A little bit of filing is needed to make them fit. I always think putting the windows in is pretty tedious, but it's something you have to do. I'm gluing in the windows using super glue gel, and then I will glue acetate behind the windows for the window panes. And in this building, I also glued in curtains that I had printed out from the internet, and I had used that technique in a number of my other builds, so you've seen it before. Now it's time to start assembling the building. For this, I did actually look at the instructions to make sure that there wasn't a specific order that these parts had to go into that wasn't obvious just by looking at them. But it wasn't too bad. I always have a habit of using too much glue for this, and it squeezes out the sides and leaves blobs. So I'm trying to be really careful about doing that. Maybe it doesn't look like I'm trying to be careful, but I am trying to be careful. This assembly was a little bit hard to clamp, so doing the best I can with masking tape. This is the floor of the main building, and it's a cardboard cutout. And for the cross bracing, he has marked on the cardboard where the cross bracing goes, so just a matter of installing the cross bracing. And it was kind of nice because in this case, the cross bracing came pre-cut, so it's all the correct length. I just found it easier to do every other brace and then come back in and add the missing braces. So once this is dried, I'm just going to spray paint everything brown. The kit came with rolled paper roofing, and I had used rolled paper roofing once before and I absolutely hated it, so I wasn't going to use that. This is sheet shingle from Rail Scale Models. And you can get it with an adhesive backing or without an adhesive backing. This sheet came without adhesive backing, and so I have sprayed the cardboard roof panel with spray adhesive, and I'm just sticking on the rows of shingle. One of the advantages of using the sheets without adhesive backing is it's much easier to kind of fluff and distress the shingles with a razor blade. For these coal chutes, it's actually a bit of a challenge to get them cut at the exact angle to fit onto the roof without any gaps, so I had to do some trimming. I painted the roof panels using an airbrush. I used various different shades of brown. However, I decided I didn't like the way this looked, so I went back and repainted everything gray. And it was kind of a struggle to get the exact look that I wanted, but I think I eventually got something that was pretty good. It gives you a little spacer block so you can get the correct distance between the walls on the chutes. The coal chute is kind of interesting construction. He gives you this block of wood with the notch cut out of it, and then you basically glue strips of wood to the sides. Then you cut a bunch of short strips to go on top. This is the coal bunker that goes under the track, and then the coal chute from the main building comes down into this bunker. So he gives you the pieces of wood, and you just assemble it like a box. And there's some metal wires for grating. The notches in the wood are for where the rails are going to go through. Now it's finally time to attach the floor to the main building. And here you can finally see my repainted roof that I did with an airbrush after basically masking off all of the walls. The next step that I like to do in the weathering is a wash of the folk art barn wood, sometimes mixed with folk art burnt umber, and that's what I'm doing here. I did this on both the small office building and on the main building. Once the wash is dried, then it's time for the weathering powders. And I use a mix of brown, gray, and black, and mostly brown. I apply the weathering powders using makeup brushes. I think weathering powders is really one of the best techniques you can use for weathering a building, and it really helps to cover up mistakes and also kind of brings all the colors together. After you apply weathering powders, you have to spray with some kind of a sealer, such as Tester's Dull Coat or Tamiya Flat Clear. Those are usually the two I use the most. And one thing to keep in mind is they tend to dull out the weathering powders a little bit, so it becomes a little more subtle. The black that I use is actually from MIG Pigments, and I guess it's a pigment rather than a weathering powder. I'm not sure how much of a difference that makes, but it seems to be much more intense. And you'll see that every once in a while in some of my builds, I'll get a little too much black somewhere. Right there, that black streak looks pretty intense, but it's going to tone down a little bit. Although I did make it intentionally darker because that's where the coal chute is, so I would expect a little more coal dust in that particular area of the building. In this case, after the weathering powders, I'll spray it with Tamiya Flat Clear. It's finally time to attach the corrugated roofing. So I'm using corrugated roofing from caseysworkshop.com and also metal sheet from a previous kit that I had painted and saved up. I've done several different videos with corrugated roofing, so if you watch my videos, it's probably something you've seen before, so I didn't really want to go over it again. I'm attaching the corrugated roofing using super glue gel. Once all the panels are attached, I'm going to have to go back and touch up all of the edges of the pieces. One nice thing about the metal roofing, it does fold nicely, so you can use it as the capping roofing for the top of the roof. I actually like how all the pieces have kind of a different look to them, although that may not be particularly realistic. and the office building gets covered in corrugated metal too. So I'm getting down to the end of the build. It's time to put the stairs on the building. This part of the stairs is cast metal, so I'm gluing it on with super glue gel. I'm just working on some final details here. In this area, a lot of buildings are covered with kind of a green moss or lichen, especially in the summer months. So I like to use this AK Interactive Slimy Grime. This is an enamel product. I just like rub it on the boards or whatever. So it gives a nice look and adds a little more color beyond just the grays and blacks. Vallejo also has a similar product in an acrylic. It might just be a thinned down green enamel paint that they sell for a higher price, but maybe there's something more sophisticated to it than that. The kit did come with plastic bolt heads for the support structure. I really should have put those on the support structure before I put the supports under the building, but I didn't do that. So here I'm just adding a little bit of rust to the bolt heads.